Now, ever since this whole Brexit business started, the Maybot and Jezza the Red have tried to avoid taking clear, substantive positions, fully aware that the moment they did so, large chunks of their parties would be less than happy. The Maybot's day of reckoning came last month when she was eventually forced to put her Brexit agreement to the Commons, only to see it rebuffed by one of the biggest Tory rebellions ever. Jezza's rebuffing came today when he announced what it would take for Labour to back a Maybot Brexit. Cue howls of anguish and much gnashing of teeth from Labour Remainers realising just how less likely this makes a second referendum. Just wait till they work out it makes a general election less likely too. The Labour membership, especially the young, is substantially pro-Remain, so it's unlikely they were overwhelmed by their glorious leader's olive branch, even if the Maybots eventually rejects it. But there are many in Momentum still prepared to give dear Jezza the benefit of the doubt on Europe. Here's Michael Walker from the left-wing Novara Media Group with his take of the week.
The People's Vote campaign have led the charge against Brexit, but its leaders can't see the wood from the trees. The campaign group have organised impressive marches and got vast media attention, but it's unclear they've persuaded many leavers, i.e. the people they actually need to get on side. What's more, they seem obsessed with Jeremy Corbyn, and high-profile pundits and politicians have successfully portrayed the Labour leader as a dogmatic Eurosceptic and pretty much the only person standing in the way of a second vote. But this is nonsense, and the likes of Alistair Campbell have got Remainers barking up the wrong tree. Labour's position is pragmatic, not ideological. If there was an overwhelming majority in the public in favour of a second referendum and reversing Brexit, I'm sure Labour would fall in line. But that's simply not the world we're living in. The focus on Corbyn is doubly misplaced. Labour's Brexit position is set by its MPs just as much as it is by Corbyn. With many of those in Leave seats, there aren't enough in favour of a people's vote. I'm not going to pretend Jeremy Corbyn is an ardent Remainer. His focus is to implement socialist policies that can rescue Britain from the ruinous path pursued by the Tories. And that's possible inside or outside of the EU. Labour have pursued a Brexit that minimises economic fallout. On Wednesday, they reaffirmed their commitment to staying in a customs union and keeping close to the single market. Labour are rightly focused on building bridges between people who voted Leave and people who voted Remain. They don't want to spend the next decade fighting a culture war about the EU. But it's time they stop blaming Corbyn for their own failings.
And our thanks to the London Wildlife Trust. Michael, welcome back to the programme. So, Alistair, you're barking up the wrong tree with your campaign for a second referendum.
I don't agree. I think you're wrong that we're obsessed with Jeremy Corbyn. I mean, I think Theresa May and Jeremy Corbyn are possibly the two most significant figures within the Brexit debate at the moment. So it would be strange not to be very, very interested in what they think. But I don't think we're obsessed. I think what we are obsessed with is actually trying to, and we are persuading people to come over. But we've taken a hit, partly because I think we were surprised by the way that she, after her big defeat, actually did manage to. Theresa May was partly responsible for kind of really battering the people's vote as a concept. But I think I've always felt that when the other options are all looked at and when they're examined and when they fall and when they fail in Parliament, and I suspect that this attempted Corbyn May tie-up is going to fail, I could be wrong, but I think it will, that then I think the people's vote comes very much back into play, and I suspect a lot of Labour MPs who currently don't support it will then.
Michael?
Well, I think what you've seen is many people in the People's Vote campaign have tried to target a lot of ire at Jeremy Corbyn. And I think one reason they've done that is to try and rile up his base. So I don't think there is a majority of the public who are in favour of a people's vote. I don't think there ever will be, actually. So what I see as happening is that some people in the people's vote, not all of them, there are many people in that campaign who genuinely care about staying in the EU, and all of their decisions are guided by how they best think that can be made to happen. I think there are others who recognise that a people's vote is unlikely to happen, but this is a great opportunity to try and drive a wedge between Labour's Remain supporters and Jeremy Corbyn by trying to make up that he is the one thing standing in the way.
Michael
Pitcher was remaining. Alistair was trying to rewrite history there. The second referendum was not battered back by Mrs May. What happened was that on an evening in Parliament where almost every option was voted upon, the second referendum was not voted upon because no one was willing to put it forward.
Yeah,
because correct. They knew that it would be massacred.
That's not a rewrite of history, it's just a different fact. No, it's true.
But it's running out of steam.
You've reversed the chronology.
I don't think it is running out of steam.
It's running out of steam.
You did not put it forward in the House because you knew that it would be smashed.
And as I've just said, when the other options get voted down...
For all the weeks that we had people sitting on that sofa calling for a second referendum, for all the weeks that the BBC was saying
that
there was rising momentum for a second referendum, there wasn't.
But there is.
There was a pitiful number of MPs who was willing to do it.
I think the evidence is in the polling. I think also... I agree in Parliament. I do agree in Parliament that if it was put to a vote last week, the people's vote would have been defeated.
Anyway, let's not talk about a second referendum.
I
told you that you'd got your facts wrong and reversed the chronology.
No,
that you were trying to mislead us.
No, I'm not trying to mislead you. I gave you one reason why I felt we'd lost traction.
All right, let me
put a vote for very sensible reasons.
I want to get on to Michael's point, because I think what is very interesting is that, from my point of view, Jeremy Corbyn has at last got himself into a sensible position. Mm-hmm. Why? Because what he's put forward is probably the middle position in the House of Commons. It is probably a position on which there would be a majority of members of Parliament. It is not a position to which Mrs May can move. Why? Because of the Eurosceptics and the party. Well, a mad party, people who feel things very, very strongly. Mm. But she's not able to move to that position. So at last he's taken a position which threatens to split the Conservative Party and give her real difficulty. Why it's taken him months and years to get there, I don't know.
Michael, you said that Mr Corbyn is, your word was, indifferent to the EU.
I don't think that was my word. I wouldn't say he was indifferent to the
EU.
No,
you said it was...
You said you wouldn't pretend that he was a great...
Yeah, I said he's not a dogmatic Eurosceptic, so I don't think it's his Euroscepticism that's driving Labour's policy.
He voted to leave the European Community in 1975. He voted consistently with Tory Eurosceptics in the Maastricht debates. He strongly opposed the Lisbon Treaty. He warned during the Irish referendum on it that it would create, quote, a Frankenstein. What's your definition of indifferent?
Well, one, I don't think I did say indifferent in the film, but...
Or Eurosceptic.
Well, I've said I don't think he's a dogmatic
Eurosceptic.
So let me make this clear. So Jeremy Corbyn's history is as a Eurosceptic, obviously, I'm not going to deny that. But if you look at his leadership of the Labour Party, he's shown himself to be very, very willing to compromise. Two pieces of evidence. One, he supported Remain in the referendum. I don't think he would have done that if he wasn't
leader
of the Labour Party.
He went on holiday during the referendum.
Yeah, but... What that showed was that he wasn't dogmatically... I don't think he's committed.
No, of course. Yeah.
I'm not saying he's a Europhile. He's a Eurosceptic, but I don't think he's that passionate about leaving the EU that commitment is what's driving Labour's policy.
A Frankenstein.
Well, Frankenstein... Yeah, I mean, I'm not here to relitigate everything that Jeremy Corbyn has said about the EU in the past.
Michael,
what I'm saying is that some people in the people's vote, maybe not you, Alistair, I don't want to... necessarily put that on you, have tried to make out that it's Jeremy Corbyn's dogmatism, it's Jeremy Corbyn's hatred of the EU, which is why a second vote isn't happening. And I think that's just incredibly misleading.
Your easiest defence against Andrew is to say that no dogmatic Eurosceptic would have as his position remaining in the customs union and being aligned with the single market.
I mean, Lexit, so a left-wing exit, is a legitimate position. It's not one I happen to agree with. But the idea of that is that we leave all of these economic institutions so that gives governments power to intervene in the economy in ways that the European Court of Justice might not be happy with.
But Michael...
The current proposal does none of those things. I think the current proposal is clearly a compromise which is to try and keep as many of the public on side as possible, to try and keep close relations with the EU so that we don't damage our economy whilst appeasing people who voted Leave. It's a compromise position. It's not an ideological one.
Mr Corbyn's position is a compromise, you're saying?
Yes.
Yeah.
Which is, I mean, I accept that it is, and I mean, I sort of get the feeling that the letter was slightly written in the hope and expectation that Theresa May will not touch it with a barge pole.
Yes.
And that's fine. That's fine by me, because that's another option taken off the table. But there's a couple of points I want to make. The first is that in your film, you suggested that Labour don't want to be talking about Brexit for another decade because they want to get on and do all the other stuff. But if Labour ends up supporting a version of Theresa May's deal, because she hasn't resolved the really big question about what Brexit is going to mean, what sort of Brexit it's going to be, is it going to be a Rees-Mogg-type Brexit or a Nicky Morgan-type Brexit, because that's not resolved, we're going to be talking about this for years and years and years. And if he becomes Prime Minister on the back of this, it's going to utterly define his time as Prime Minister.
Yeah, but there's no option to that.
I was asking Michael.
Well, you Michael weren't asking anyone. He asked the question here.
Oh, I see.
You and I debate.
Oh, good.
Of course it's going to dominate British politics for decades. I would say decades, up to a century. But
we were going to get clarity. She told us we were going to get clarity. Yeah, yeah. She told us we were going to know where we were going.
But what you want, which is to frustrate the will of the British people by remaining in the European Union...
I want the British people also to have a choice about...
Will
whether
also
they
lead
to, go ahead with
to decades and decades of controversy.
No, I don't think it will, because I think the problem will not to do it.
Well, that's the arrogance that got us where we are.
Mr. Corbyn was one of the features of his leadership has been to give members a crucial say in Labour policy. 72% of Labour members want a second referendum. What happened to listening to the members?
I think in terms of Labour's Brexit position, in terms of what the public want, I think is clear. I think his position is what the public want. It's not necessarily what the members want or what Labour voters want.
But Labour policy is meant to be determined by the members. Well, the members want a second referendum.
Labour's policy is determined at conference. So there was a conference motion which was passed, and that actually gave the leadership a lot of freedom. And I don't think that was an accident. I think that's because the people in that room recognised that the leadership needed quite a lot of freedom.
But that policy,
it's not polling companies.
That policy was first of all to have a general election. That was the main. Then other options, if we don't get that, other options would follow, including a second vote. The no confidence vote failed. There's no immediate sign of a general election. So shouldn't there now be a special Labour conference to determine if Labour should back a second referendum? Shouldn't the Labour members get to speak?
Well, as Alistair says, we've just come up now with a policy. He's written a letter, which Alistair thinks is going to split the Conservative Party. So I think this idea that a general election is now off the table.
No, but if
silly. Tory MPs who are speaking to their constituency parties to say, prepare for a general election. And then there's all these people in the media who are saying it's off the table.
There's not going to be an election. But if that letter gets rejected, if Theresa May says, no, Jeremy, I know what you're up to, I'm not playing this game, where does he go then? Surely the logic that was spelled out at the Labour Party conference was that by this stage in the process, Labour would be campaigning for a people's vote with the option to remain.
God, it's like...
Sorry, that's the policy.
It's like a broken record, isn't
it? That's the policy.
On and on about this second referendum.
Can I go back to
the policy?
Michael, let me just make one point, because it's another point about...
It'll be very important.
Why I think Corbyn has done quite well. Firstly, I think, you know, he's now reached an established position, and there was evidence in the polls that people were frustrated because he didn't appear to have a position.
Now there's a substantive position.
Now he seems to have a position. The second thing is, if he's gone against the membership, which I think he has in this regard, that will only be a plus for the general public. Because if the public believes that he's always going to be dictated to by a membership of 500,000, which is a very small part of the British public, then they'll be very worried about that. So I think actually it's a double hit.
Well, I think that's wishful thinking on your part.
Michael, don't you worry in the broader scheme of things that it may be all over bar the shouting? The latest national poll gives the Tories a 7-point lead over Labour. I mean, if you look at the mess of things, they've got a 7-point lead. And who would you prefer as Prime Minister? 40% Mrs. May, 19% Mr. Corbyn. 19 against Mrs. May.
To
repeat Diane Abbott's correct point, which she was falsely corrected for on Question Time, we are, if you look at the polls of polls, pretty much neck and neck.
This is the latest poll.
What I say about these polls and why they're going to be neck and neck, and why I want to get Brexit out of the way, and I think it also relates to your point, which you think this is going to dominate politics for the next 10 years, whatever happens. I think in terms of the evening shows, Brexit probably will dominate politics for the next 10 years. But what I want to see is the national conversation move away from Brexit. And I think why we can't get away from Brexit at this point as an all-consuming issue is because people who voted Leave are terrified that Remainers are conspiring to reverse the referendum, and people who voted Remain are terrified that we're going to get some ERG-type hard Brexit. And so what I think is if we say, if we rule out both of those, rule out a hard Brexit, rule out Remain, and we can move on.
Right, that's all very well. You cannot be happy that only 19% of this country would prefer Mr Corbyn as Prime Minister.
I mean, again, this is Groundhog Day. This is what was said in 2016. So one, I think, in terms
21
of
21-point lead, Theresa May.
It was. I'm sure it was the same in 2016.
Given where she is now.
So I mean, one way of looking at this is, I think Labour are going to struggle to break through when Brexit is the major issue.
It
I think also
it
Jeremy Corbyn.
You.
No, well, obviously, I prefer it to be higher.
But if it doesn't bother
I still think
you,
he's the best person to take Labour into the next general election.
I understand that, Michael. Thank you.